Just wanted to say how much I appreciated the Recorder Quartet today for the anthem and certainly the introit as well. Certainly brings back memories from when we were growing up, right, in music class. Maybe for some of us, not so good memories. Yeah, I don't know if you'd want that, me playing a recorder, Simon. But our scripture reading today comes from the book of Romans, chapter 12. Verses 9 through 16. Listen to the words of the Lord. Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Honor one another above yourselves. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor, serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Share with God's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn with those who mourn. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Loving and gracious God, we thank you for your word. Lord, we pray that your word might penetrate our hearts and change our thoughts and actions this day. God, I pray that your words may be mine. In your name, amen. I believe the clock is 5 minutes slow, in case you're wondering about your watches and looking at the time, and I do know that, so I'll keep that in mind. I don't have five extra minutes, okay? So I'll keep that in mind today. Happy Mother's Day, certainly to all the moms out there. It's a wonderful day to celebrate mothers. And when I was thinking about when I was growing up, when did I need my mom the most? I needed my mom the most when I was either hurt emotionally or physically. Maybe some of you can relate. And growing up, I was a little bit of an accident waiting to happen, okay? A little clumsy. I'm sure some of you are saying, well, that's not surprising, Ted. And that's certainly true. Mom needed a lot of tender care for her youngest child, Teddy, as she liked to call me. Well, 2 weeks ago, I could have really used my mom's tender care. You see, a member here at Highland invited me to do the Shady's Rugged Run at Lancaster Bible College. If you don't know anything about that run, it's a mini mutter run. Does anyone know what a mutter run is out there? Maybe a few of you. You're thinking, Ted, what were you thinking as you know about what that run's all about? Basically, it's 3.5 miles through mud and different obstacles. It's not just a race. You have to climb up a 15-foot wall and jump off numerous times. You have to climb over a barn dwelling. You have to run through fire. Now, it's kind of on the sides, but you're still kind of running through fire. You have to crawl under barbed wire. Do you think it's a good idea for me to do a race like that? Absolutely not. Where was my mom to say, what are you thinking, Edward? You know, but it was Scott Orndorff, and he's kind of a strong guy, you know, tough guy. I'm like, yeah, I can do this. I think they call him Tough Mudders, right? Although it was a mini mudder, don't get me wrong. I can do it. But I'm thinking, what am I getting myself into? And I'm thinking about, oh, yeah, that's right. When I got psychologically evaluated to become a minister some 15 years ago, do you know that one of the results said this? That I had a high interest in adventure, but a low skill level, okay? Now, I really don't find that funny, okay? I have a challenge, okay? We all have challenges in life, right? So again, what am I thinking, right, doing this mutter run? Roger, really, please try to compose yourself, okay? My goodness. You know my challenges. This guy ran the Boston Marathon. This guy's got some talent. As opposed to me. There's a reason why I'm the associate pastor. Okay, anyway, moving along. So anyway, maybe not for long, by the way, but that's not funny. Okay, I have kids to feed at home, okay? So anyway, get my composure here, right? So it's race day, right? And let me tell you, I am nervous. I mean, Scott's there and he's looking tough and I'm trying to look tough, but deep down I'm going, dear God, please let me not die. Dear God, please let me not die. By the way, my wife told me to raise the life insurance, which I did, for the race as well. She was prepared, and she knew what was about to happen. So anyway, barbed wire, climbing over farm dwellings, you know, again, crazy stuff, right? Well, the race begins, and the first part of the race is the easiest part of the race. It's a quarter mile run. No big deal, right? And then the first stage is going over a balance beam, okay? A 4 foot high balance beam. There are about four of these 2x4s together. And I'm behind some of these young lads, okay, trying to keep up with these younger guys, right? And I see them run over the beam, right? About five runs, five steps, and they're off the beam. And I'm thinking, I can do that. I can run over that beam, not a problem. So I get on that beam, folk. Let me tell you, one, two steps, all of a sudden, I'm in midair. Do you know what I mean? And then, boom, on my leg, down onto the ground. I am down for the count. I mean, I've never experienced pain in my life before like this. I mean, maybe this is what childbirth is all about. I mean, I have extreme pain, okay? Ladies, I can identify. All right? What are you talking about? It was extreme pain. For at least 2 minutes, right, ladies? I mean, it doesn't last long, right? So it's really sad, folk. I mean, I'm crawling over to the side with this extreme pain, by the way, that I had for at least 2.5 minutes. I'm sorry. And so Lancaster Bible College students are coming over. They're like praying for me. I mean, it's really, they're not quite doing that, but they're like, sir, do you need an ambulance? And I'm like, I think I hurt my leg. You know, I'm in such pain. I mean, it's so sad. And Scott, my friend here from church, great member, he's like, Dad, are you okay? And I'm like, I don't know. I think I broke my leg. And I mean, I had a contusion, by the way, from my hip all the way down to my thigh muscle. I mean, I really got myself. I think my ribs were killing me. I mean, it was not looking pretty. And Scott's like, Dad, you want to keep going? I'm like, what? What are you, crazy? Is my wife behind this? I know she upped the insurance. And I'm like, all right, I think I can. And I mean, it was sad, me running, you know, it was so sad. But fortunately, believe it or not, I was able to finish the race. It was a minor, maybe a major miracle. But let me tell you, folk, have you ever hurt yourself in the ribs before? I mean, I was in major pain. In fact, I had to call in Dr. Rothacker, okay, to check me out. And it looks like I bruised, maybe cracked some ribs, okay? So I really got myself really good. But at the same time, it was a great experience. I was able to get across that finish line. So do you think I want to do it again? Absolutely want to do it again. All right? So we're trying to get some Highland folks to do that next year, by the way. So let me know. Men and women, a lot of women ran in the race. A lot of women passed me in the race, okay? Where are you going with this, Ted, right? Well, it made me think about my mom. I would do a lot of dumb things, obviously, growing up. And when I'd come in hurt or just doing something stupid, mom would say, if I told you once, I told you 1,000 times. Do you know that momism? I told you not to climb that tree. I told you not to go play in the poison ivy. Duh. What were you thinking? Do you remember some of those momisms growing up? And I decided to go on the internet and see what some of those sayings were that mom would always say to us, or maybe even dad. And maybe some of these sayings you've said as well. Close the door, you don't live in a barn, right? Remember that one? Don't go out with a wet head, you'll catch a cold, right? Life isn't fair. I hated that one. I say it, by the way. Now come back downstairs and go back up without stomping your feet. Remember that one? I still say that. Say that again and I'll wash your mouth out with soap. Who, by the way, had their mouth literally washed out by soap, that was certainly me, right? Okay, yep. Not allowed to do that any longer. Oy. What part of no don't you understand? Remember that one? Who do you think you are? Just a kid, Mom. When I was your age, I had to walk 10 miles through the snow uphill, right? To get to school, right? Actually, my mom had to. She grew up in Maine. I don't even think they had cars. Why? Because I said so. That's why. You better wipe that smile off your face. Whew, that got me chilly there. I brought you into this world and I can take you out. I've actually heard a mom say that one time and I was not hanging out at that house any longer. I don't care what everybody else is doing. I care about what you are doing. And isn't that the bottom line with those momisms? That our mothers really care about us. They're so concerned. They're so worried about what's going to happen to us. Because they love us, right? I knew that my mom loved me no matter what, whether she said it or not. I knew when I had that boo-boo, she was going to put me on that rocking chair and rock me back and forth. She was going to say it's going to be okay. She loved me unconditionally. She was always going to be there for me. I'm sure many of us can identify with that kind of a mother's love. Here's a young boy describing how much he enjoys his mom. He asked his mom, "So, Mom, how old were you when I was born?" Mom said, "I was 23. And he said, "Wow, that's a lot of time we missed spending together." Gotta love that little boy's perspective of spending time with his mom. He missed those 23 years. I missed 39. I'm sure we've all missed many years. Some of us don't have our mothers any longer. That's certainly my case, and I miss my mom so, so much. I wish she could have kissed my boo-boo 2 weeks ago. Emily Dickinson said this, "A mother is to whom you hurry when you are troubled." And that certainly was true for me growing up. The prophet Isaiah said, "As a mother comforts her child, so too does God comfort you." And that reminds me, when we experience a mother's love and her comfort, we're experiencing God's love and His comfort. That truly moms are a love in action. And I believe that's what the Apostle Paul was communicating in his letter to the church in Rome today. That the church was to put love into action. In the first 11 chapters of Romans, he's talking about the theology of faith, the gospel, what it means and how we believe our faith to be true. It was about doctrine. But now in chapter 12, he's saying you got to put that doctrine into practice. You got to put your faith into action. You got to put your love into action. They were strong words for a church that was struggling, a church that was divided. It was fragmented. It wasn't getting along. You see, it was filled with Jewish Christians and Gentile Christians. And they practiced their faith in a different way. And they couldn't see eye to eye. And they looked down upon one another. They judged one another. And Paul was saying, put your differences aside and love one another in Jesus Christ. That's what's going to unify you. And if you love one another, those differences aren't just going to matter, because you're going to agree on the love of Jesus Christ. And that's what's going to bring you together as a church, loving one another as I have loved you. A strong, strong word for the church, a church that needed those words. I believe a church that needs those words today as well. And let's look at the text. In verse 10, the Apostle Paul writes, "Be devoted to one another in brotherly love." And the word for brotherly love is Philadelphia. We certainly know that Philadelphia, right? The city of brotherly love. Don't always think about it as being that kind of a city. Grew up there. It's a passionate city, but it can go either way when it comes to love, right? But the Apostle Paul was saying, you need to love one another. Philos, to love one another. Adelphos, to love your brethren, your brothers and sisters in Christ. You are to have a familial love for one another. It's that love that you're always going to love one another no matter what you do. No matter how much you disagree, you've been called to forgive, to reconcile with one another, and to love one another, to get along as the church. That's my calling for you. A strong word, Philadelphia. A strong word, I believe, for the church today. Folk, what I want to say today, that the church has wonderful, genuine, sincere opportunities for relationships that really matter in life. I believe that this is the best place that you can have a true, authentic relationship with another brother and sister in Christ. That you can talk about things that matter. That you can pray with one another. That we can have depth together as the family of faith. Because we live in a world where you can't find those kind of relationships. The world is divided and fragmented. It's hurting. In fact, I was reading in Newsweek an older issue. in 2009, and the title of the article was this, A Lonely Planet. And that article said that loneliness has tripled in America in the past 10 years. In America now, there are 75 million Americans that describe themselves as lonely. And do you know what they say in regards to loneliness? People say that they don't have one person in their life that they can talk about things that matter. Can you believe that? Not one person in their life. 300 million Americans. Not one person. 75 million Americans. You know what the article also said was this, that social networking is not helping loneliness. In fact, the article cited that nothing can replace face-to-face human contact, brothers and sisters in Christ caring with one another. Did you hear the text today? Rejoicing with one another, mourning with one another, laughing with one another, sometimes at our expense, and certainly today that was my case, but I'm happy for that as well. But that's the kind of church we are to be. That's the kind of relationships that we are to have. But we have to be together in relationship. We have to have contact with one another. And I don't care how old you are, how young you are, or what your age is, we've been called to be in relationship with our brothers and sisters in Christ. It reminds me about 9 years ago. My daughter was 5 years old, and she was diagnosed with a tumor in her finger. An incredibly anxious time for Heather and I, and certainly for Taylor as well. We had to admit her into Children's Hospital of Philadelphia. It was the day before surgery, and we were scared. We were worried. It was a difficult time. And I'll never forget a knock on the door. Taylor, Taylor, it's Anna. Can I come in? Taylor said, come on in, Anna. Anna, her best friend, who was 5 years old as well, runs into the room, jumps onto the bed. Taylor, it's so good to see you. I love you. Here's a card. Taylor, been thinking about you, been praying for you. I love you. Love, Anna. And wow, I wasn't quite sure if she should be on the bed and jumping on my daughter, but at the same time, Anna was showing my daughter the love of Jesus Christ. And they were laughing and they were enjoying each other's company. And suddenly Taylor's anxieties, you could see it, suddenly began to subside just a little bit. And so too did her parents' worries begin just to subside a little bit. Well, it was time for breakfast, and Taylor's food came in, and she wasn't really hungry, and then Anna started eating her food, which was a typical Anna thing. And then this is what Anna said. She said, boy, these doctors, they sure make good food. Cute, cute girl. You gotta love Anna. And Taylor and Anna are still good friends today, even though she lives a bit of a distance away. But they share the love of Christ with one another, even at age 5. When Taylor was hurting, she needed her friend Anna. And what did Anna do? She had to come and see Taylor ASAP. And folk, we all desire those kind of relationships. God created us to be in relationship with Him and one another. That's how it works. We long for that. We strive for that. That's why so many people feel lonely in America, because they don't have that. They don't have that deep Christ-centered relationship in their life where someone's going to care for them no matter what, that someone's going to be there for them no matter what. They're going to be loved on by the unconditional love of God. Folk, you can't find those relationships anywhere else, I believe, but in the church. The Apostle Paul then goes on to write in verses 11 and 13. He writes, be faithful in prayer and practice hospitality. And isn't that what Anna was doing? Putting her prayer into action? And hospitality in the reverse, if you will, she came to visit Taylor, not inviting her into her home, but isn't that being hospitable? Going out and reaching out to someone? Actually going and visiting someone? Do you know how much that means? That's what it means to be the church, to love on each other no matter what, to go out and to visit one another, to go out and to care for one another, especially when we're going through difficult times in life. And as I close today, I want to focus in on being faithful in prayer. Folks, what I want to say today, that prayer is the most intimate thing that you could do with another brother or sister in Christ. To hold hands together, to pray with one another, and to pray for one another. To bring Jesus Christ at the center of your relationship. There's not a more powerful gift that you could give to a brother or sister in Christ. Jesus said, whenever two or three are gathered, that I am with you. That when we pray together, the presence of Christ is with us. When we praise Him and give Him thanks, and when we bring up our concerns to God. And folk, when we do that together, it is powerful. It is profound. It deepens our relationships in ways that relationships can only be deepened through prayer, nothing else. And this past Tuesday, I realized how important and how powerful prayer is with a sister in Christ. And that sister is my cousin, Vicky. And I've shared her story before. Vicky, 2 years ago, at age 36, was stricken with a horrific stroke where she was in a hospital for a year on a ventilator at all times, bedbound and then wheelchair-bound. The past year, she's been in a nursing home, trying to rehab and get better. But worst of all, for 2 years, she's been separated from her two twins, who just turned 12, and her loving husband. Can you imagine being separated from your children for 2 years because of what has occurred in her life? And the emotional and the mental anguish that that has caused her, the spiritual pain as well, wondering, God, where are you in this? Well, she's been getting better. There has been some good news. And I saw her about a month ago, and the hope was that she would go home today on Mother's Day. What a great Mother's Day present for my cousin Vicky, right? Being able to go home to be with her children, even though she was still going to be in a wheelchair, even though she was still going to be on a ventilator at night, she could be with Susie and Michael. She could be with her husband, Sean. And so when I went on Tuesday to be with Vicky, I thought it was going to be a time of celebration, a time of joy that we're going to talk about today and how exciting that today was going to be. And when I came into the room, I said, Vicky, how you doing? Vicky said, Teddy, not so good. Yesterday I found out that I'm not able to go home on Sunday. Now they're still saying that I can go home maybe July or August, but I can't go on Mother's Day. I was hoping so much to go. And you could see her disappointment. I said, Vicky, well, how are things going today? She said, Teddy, I want you to know, every day I pray to God. Every day I say, God, allow me to be your vessel of love to a nurse, to a resident, or to my children when I talk to them on the phone. I say, God, I don't have much. I'm bound to this wheelchair. I can't leave this facility, but God, somehow, someway, use me. Use me to be your vessel of love. And folks, when Vicky showed me that faith, that deep-rooted faith, she became a vessel of God's love to me, that she had a purpose in loving her cousin Teddy on Tuesday. Folks, she's able to get through these difficult times because she feels like God has a purpose in her life, that God can use her to be a vessel of love and care for those around her, even though her situation is anything close in the way that she would want it to be. And normally I would close our times with saying, Vicky, can I pray? But you know what I said on Tuesday? I said, Vicky, can you pray for me? I can't remember the last time I asked someone to pray for me. And Vicky took my hand, and she began to pray for my children, my wife, for my family. God's love flowing from her. She was a vessel to me. And then, folks, she quoted me Jeremiah 29:11 in her prayer. One of my favorite texts in all of Scripture. I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. And when she prayed those words of Scripture, I just began to weep and weep and weep. Vicky was being a vessel of God's love to me. His hands of peace, comfort, and hope were upon me, even though she was the one in the wheelchair. God was using her. She was putting His love into action. And folk, that is God's calling for us, the church today, to be His love in action. In all that we do and all that we say, whomever we might come in contact with, no matter our limitations, no matter our challenges, no matter our struggles, folk, God can use us to build His kingdom in simple ways and in extraordinary ways, with an embrace, with a hug, with a kind word, with a prayer for another brother or sister in Christ. Folk, I believe that's our calling as the church today. And so today is a wonderful day to love mothers and to appreciate them and to pray with them and for them. But it's also a day to appreciate all of God's people. Maybe to appreciate someone in this sanctuary today who has inspired you in your journey of faith. And you just want to say a kind word to them before you leave today. Or maybe you know someone in this church who's going through a hard time. And maybe before you go today to the busy activities that we might have on a Mother's Day, can we say a prayer together? Can we pray together before we leave? But I know today is busy, so maybe in the days and weeks to come, I encourage you to put your love into action and to be the church that God has called us to be and to love one another with deep-rooted, Christ-centered relationships. Because when we love others, we experience God's love in our lives in life-changing ways. Let us love in action. Amen.